Goedemiddag, mensen. My name is Norbert Engelbert from Optimal Thermal Solutions. Thank you for joining the webinar, which we will give together with Telerex. OTS and Telerex are working together since 2008. And at Telerex, I give courses. And now, because of the corona, we decided to do this as a webinar. So I'm very happy that you all will join. If you have questions, just ask them in the chat and I will handle them afterwards. Now I like to start. I will present in English because a few people which will join are from the English language. So but you can also ask your questions in Dutch if you like. Good. Today I like to discuss why thermal simulation. What can thermal simulation can do for us as an engineer in your design process? In the past, I think if I look for myself, I started 25 years ago with thermal simulations. But before, we always did experimental testing, and still I see a lot of companies are doing a lot of experimental testing, which of course is always important. But also thermal simulations will really help in the design process of your new product. And it will really help to get the guess out of your design. And you are able in a previous state to know what your product is doing. And even now, it's not necessary that really the design is made. If you just have some ideas when you're in the architectural phase, you already can set up some simulations to check if it is feasible, yes or no. So it can also help you to set up requirements and help with the initial product design before you really start any real design. Yeah, as I said, you have experimental methods and you have thermal simulations tools. What I see nowadays is that thermal simulation tools are becoming more and more common. You see it in the larger companies. People have it. You see that engineers learn it at the university. And if they not have the ability to buy or make use of this kind of tools, then it's possible to work with design houses as OTS. Yeah, the thermal simulations can be used in all design phases, at the start, in the middle, at the end. And I will guide you through, show some examples what simulation can do for us. And if you have questions at the end, please ask. Yeah, if you look to a product design, you always start with a specification. When you have the specification, you can define the problem statement. You can draw then a schematic. You have to look for the properties and you make some assumptions. And at the end, yeah, the specification need to lead to a solution. And we have different methods for that. We have the analytical calculation, which was mainly done a lot in the past, but still it's very worthwhile to do, very good to do that. Also, when I teach my course, I teach also the analytical approach, while it gives you really a quick insight in what your problem is. And you can run some simple severity studies in Excel. Another tool what we can work with is the numerical, so the computer simulation, and we also and that I will discuss more in this presentation, and the experimental approach, which is known by most of you, I think. When using those three methods, you always have to look to a verification calibration process. So when you run an analytical calculation, you like to check it with the experimental approach. And if they are close together, then you know that you did a good job while you did make use of two methods. And that will bring you can bring you to the solution. The same should be done when you run a numerical analysis. When you run a numerical analysis, it's also good to run some analytical, and sometimes you also need to run some experimental approach. mainly to get the right numbers, both to be used in your numerical or in your analytical simulation. Now, and if let's go back a little bit, if you have done well and everything is within spec, then you have a solution and you're done. If not, you have to maybe redefine your problem statement, do this again, and then you have to run it around and around until you have the solution. And sometimes it can be the case that you don't can find a solution, then you really have to redefine your problem statement. For instance, you have a housing where you like to dissipate a certain amount of wattage, you like to cool it with natural convection, it appears that it is not possible, then you maybe have to look for something else. Maybe you have to increase the size of the enclosure, or you have to advance, or maybe some more sophisticated stuff. So the approaches what can be used is analytical. That is just the hand calculations. And in the top, you see some analytical calculation of a LED luminaire, which is used on boats. Based on analytical calculation, you can just set up a calculation model in which you can easily change some parameters and check what the impact is. For instance, if you have to deal with solar load, if you have to deal with different power dissipation, the size of your enclosure, well, all that kind of simple things can be done by analytical calculation, and you can do very quick what-if-then analysis. But yeah, the analytical calculations are mainly based on 1D thermal resistances, and that's so you don't take into account spreading resistance and 3D effects. So that is also the limit of this calculation, but it gives you a quick view insight of what is important here. Then a numerical, and that's what I'm talking today. You can put your whole thermal problem, you can put in a 3D package, and there you can set it up. You can put components on boards, you can put copper in board, you can put thermal fires in board, you can put fans in, you can put enclosure in, you can put solar load, whatever you want, you can put in. And you can make visible in 3D what the conductivity is, how the heat is spread through the materials, but also you see convection and radiation taking place. So you get really a good view of what's happening. And if you change things, you also see in 3D what is happening and why it is happening. And that helps you to look in solutions. This is also possible with experimental approach, but the main benefit of CFD is that you can run it much more quickly, and also you can look much more in detail while you have a lot more monitor points, so temperature sensors or flux sensors or velocity sensors available within your computational model, what is that's not practical in experimental approach. Yeah, in the bottom you see experimental testing. That's the third method, and what you see below is just an infrared picture which can help you when you power the printed circuit board to check if you see hotspots which were not expected. Now, for all the three methods, it's always important to run at least two methods. So analytical numerical, analytical experimental, experimental numerical, and why. If you do that and both give the same order of magnitude of results, then you know you did a good engineering job. And if based on that you make decisions and you make designs which meet both requirements, then you know that you have a solution which is first the right time. So only running one is not recommended. You should always run two or three of the analysis. Then, what's numerical approach? Numerical methods you make use of simplification of your complex 3D phenomena. But you can make it as difficult as you like. For instance, if you like to model a component, you can really go up to junction. You can model all transistors within your IC and really also put transient analysis in to see what is happening there. And even you can go up to, if you have a big data center, you can model the whole room and look what is possible there. But to make some quicker what if then analysis, it's in most cases, it's better to put some simplifications in, otherwise your computational model will become really heavy. And although we have very powerful computers nowadays, still putting too much detail in will slow down your simulation process and give as a drawback that you cannot run very quickly and do a lot of what if then analysis in a few hours. The benefit also of the numerical, you can put in complex shapes and problems. We're really in analytical modeling, that's not possible. You can see spreading resistance in 3D. You can read in your geometry, your 3D geometry for mechanical stuff and make use of that within your simulation models. Important to know also here, but that's also for analytical analysis, but also for experimental approach, garbage in, it's garbage out. You really need to put the right figures in, the right data in to get results which are in line with the reality. In most cases, what I see that mainly power dissipation values are very hard to estimate right. But also all details, if you run a board analysis, you never will put all component data, board data, thermal interconnects in to make it like reality. So you also have to do a simplification there. And yeah, the way of simplification and the way of things you assume will give a good or wrong end result. One of the most important aspects of computational fluid dynamic, that's the way of modeling, what we mainly use, where you also model the flow, is that you get more insight in what your problem statement is. So, you can you see the temperature, but also see the flow. You can make visible the heat flux. You can really see in a view what is taking place, and that can help you to look into solutions, which is much more difficult if you're an experimental approach. Although you have to do both. Certainly, if you have very difficult problems, also for CFD, you have to run experimental testing. Take care of independent solution result to verify results of the simulation. It's also always recommended to run some experimental tests to verify if your solution setup, your simulation model setup is quite correct. So if you run a heatsink and you like to run some improvement studies, it's good to know that of the initial heatsink what you modeled, that you know what the experimental results are. So that the order of magnitude is right. But yeah, the main use of CFD study is to do what-if-then studies and not really look to the absolute values of the temperatures. Now, I said, compare the results obtained by the different methods. And if the results are within acceptable margins, then you have confidence in your results and you can consider that it is high, so you can proceed. If differences are great with acceptable margin and acceptable margin, for instance, that if you look to experimental, you have a margin of say 10%. If you look to CFD, so computational study, you have a margin of 20%. And yeah, if the order of magnitude, if the outcome of the different methods is comparable, then you can say, okay, I did have a good solution. I modeled it right, so I can trust the results. Now, computational fluid dynamic can be used for all industry and on all levels. You can really go from component level. And really, here you see a heatsink with a component below it, but you can also go within the component. So really model the chip, the transistors and everything, and do an optimization step there. In most cases, you run a component level model where you have a heatsink on the component and the component is placed on a board. But you can then go to board level where you also look to the behavior of different components together, airflow over the components, how does the whole thing work together. If you put a heat sink on a component, what will be the effect, and what will not only the effect on the component the heat sink has, but also on the components surrounding it. You can look to subchassis, you can look to chassis or cabinet, and even you can go to a full data center with 100, for instance, 100 or more cabinets, and that you look to the air temperature going into the cabinets. Of course, you can understand that within the data center simulation, you cannot put that much detail in. So component chips are not put in, but subchassis in a very simplified way can be used within data center simulation. So you run it on all levels, and also this is important when you do a design. And if you don't know what boundary conditions to be used in the other simulations, maybe you have to run first a data center analysis, then a chassis level, then a subchassis, a board, and then a component level analysis. So then you can go into more detail. Yeah, things you can gain here. For instance, there are some examples of computational fluid dynamic simulations done. The first one on the left is the junction level simulations. This is a die. I think it was 1 by 1 millimeter, where we look to the details of a hot junction, which was did have transient so pulsating power, and we checked what the temperature effect is. Yeah, normally this kind of work is done by the Intels. And all kind of component suppliers. But yeah, if you are located there, then you have to run this kind of analysis. Then the second one is a board level analysis, where we have a rack with containing two boards which were stacked on each other. And we look to the effect of each of the component temperature of each board. But we also look to the interaction between the two boards. Then you see a detailed board level analysis, which is more at the right top side, where we really did put all copper in, a detailed component. This was, this was an LED which was modeled, but we also did put all vias in, which need to bring the heat from the top side to the back side of the board. And yeah, you can check here the result. What is the effect of the thermal vias? How much vias do you need to put in? Are the vias below the die more important than the vias next to the die? What is the effect of copper thickness? All that kind of studies can easily be done. Then below that, the system level of an outdoor box, where also solar load was put on, so you can there study the effect, for instance, of wind and other stuff, but also of solar load. And then on the most right side, you see a thermal simulation of a street lamp. This was a request of one of my customers. They did have four LED sources in the lamp. And before they were planning to order the mold for the street lamp, which is in most cases very costly. They like to know for sure if thermally the whole thing was okay. And the thermal simulation can help you to really investigate if the results are within expectation, and you can do simple improvements and check what the result is. For instance, if you like to do a weight reduction, you can easily see what the effect is after running the thermal simulations. Now, this is really a simplified problem statement, where we have a rack containing several printed circuit boards. We have on the right-hand side, we have a fan, which is sucking the air through the system. We have a vent where the air is going in the system at the left-hand side. Each board will dissipate 4 watts uniformly. This is very simplified, but yeah, these thermal simulations can help you. You can easily set this up. This will take maybe half an hour or so to set this up, and then you can run a simulation and see how well it works. Now, after the first run, we saw that the middle boards were becoming very hot, and that the boards at the outside walls were much lower in temperature. At the left-hand side, you see 54. At the right-hand side, you see 51. Yeah, and the question is, why is this happening? Now, if we make the airflow visible, then we see that most of the air is coming in via the vent at the left hand side and is then directly bypassing all the boards and is going into the fan, so it's removed and there is almost no air movement in between the boards, and that's also why it is becoming very hot there. You also see that the board at the left hand side is becoming cold because all the fresh air coming from outside is just going next to the board. Here you can look in more detail from the from top view what how is the airflow going, and there you also see that in this velocity profile what you see here that the velocity in between the boards is very low and at the outside it's very high. Now what we of course like to see is that the airflow in between the boards is relatively high. Now an easy fix here can be to add a baffle so that we put more some air restriction in, so that the air is that the path through the boards is much more easy than bypassing the boards. And yeah, now we can check what the result is. Now you see already what's happening. You see the board temperatures are reducing. You see that overall temperature are dropped, but still you see that yeah, the second board from the left hand side is still becoming hot. So more studies can be done. Maybe you can add a grill below the boards and some other stuff. But you see that what you see is what you get. You can easily investigate what's happening here. Of course, this is also when you run an experimental test. You measure the board temperature, you see that things are becoming hot. But you have to put really a lot of sensors, the velocity sensors, in to check what's happening. This kind of studies just take a few hours and you already have an insight what's happening. And this can help you to yeah, with some changes you can see when the result is within expectation. And then you can yeah, set up maybe an experimental test, put the modification in, and then check if in reality this is okay. Good. So the first simulation, the original is given in the bottom side at the left hand side, and then you see in the top side the modified one, and you see that we got quite some drop in temperature, but still the second board is too hot, so some more analysis can be done. Good. Yeah, that is just in a quick overview what just for a simple rack like this simulation tools can do for you. Then another really important thing for certainly for thermal simulation is to look how well heat is spread. Certainly if you look to a printed circuit board, you see it in the bottom pictures where we made infrared pictures of the printed circuit board. You see an heating up effect. Air is coming from the bottom, is exiting at the top. You see that the components at the bottom are lower and that the ones above are hotter. Yeah, thermal simulation can make this visible. So you don't need really a board already, and you can do some modifications. You can change your placement. You can add more copper. You can add heatsink, and you can then come up with a really optimized design. And yeah, you know for sure after that's optimized that if you build it afterwards, that it will also give optimal results. Now in the bottom side, you also see the study of the of an LED, what I also shown on previous pages, where you really can look to the spreading resistance and the effect of thermal fires in your board. Things what you can, for instance, also investigate. Can I still deal with a PCB, which is only a PCB, or do it with FR4, or do I need to move to a metal core PCB? Heater spreading, yeah, things what you for instance see here, things you can change the placement so that if the hot air comes from the bottom, if you put all components on top of each other, then you have a staggering effect. If you change it, if you change the move the components a little bit more, then you see that there is more heat spreading, and that will lead to lower component temperatures. Now, this was a full study on the effect of double fires below a component. You see just below the die, we will put a lot of thermal fires in and then somewhat lesser around the die. So it's still below the component and you can look to the effectiveness. You see in the right section at the top that also all the copper layers are put in place. So you can also see how the heat is spread within the copper. Certainly if you make use of flux plot. So how much watt per meter square is moving and where is it removing. So you really see the path. And if you put the thermal fires in, you really see that the heat is mainly going through the copper and then it's going into the planes. Yeah, so you see that in the bottom, you see the temperature plot, and at the right-hand side, you see the heat flux plot, and there you really can nicely see that the heat is going from the copper, is going from the fires from the top layer to the second layer, and then via the other fires which are next to the component, it goes downwards to the plane at the other side. Yeah, nice studies. What you can do is to check to the effect if you copper of if you fill the fires or if you make use of thicker copper planes. Now this was a study where we need to check what now let's say the top circuitry, which is now located at the bottom, was a sensitive circuitry which should not be influenced by the circuitry which is above, which can switch on and off. We put a split in the copper. You see that in the right-hand side picture. We put some split in the copper planes, and you see that by switching on and off the electronics in the top area, you see that the effect on the lower area is just low. Now, this is something you can think of, but the CFD will help you to really visualize that that this is possible and works. Some other studies, for instance, in the top you see a heatsink design. You really see the spreading of the heat in the heatsink, and you see how well the heat is moved to the fins. The same you see for the pin fin heatsink, and yeah, in the past for Lemnis we did we looked to the heatsink design for an LED-based lamp. Then the computer server, computer servers was located in a data center, and we saw that some of the stuff was coming hot. Yeah, and mainly what you can really see, visualize here, that air is moved from the hot azole to the cold azole, is sucked in again. So the air, the air is heated, preheated before it goes into the second server. This kind of studies. And after done, you think, okay, yeah, this was clear. But before, sometimes you really don't know what is happening. And CFD computational studies will help you to make that visible. So yeah, and an important thing or an example case is optimizing a heatsink design. Things what we like to do here is just increase the number of fins. I have a heatsink which is used for natural convection. And I like to see what the effect is of adding more fins or reducing the number of fins. Now, this you can set this up and then you can run a lot of thermal simulations. And then you can check what the effect is. Now, in the graph in the bottom, you see what the effect is for the number of fins. And you see that there is an optimum. If you have two less fins, then temperature increases. If you increase the fin account, then you see that the temperature drops to a certain moment, then it starts to increase again. While yeah, if you have the fins too close, then not cold air can go in between the fins and the temperature are rising again. So certainly for natural convection heatsink, it's important that you don't have too many fins, that there is sufficient gap for the air to go through and to bring the heat from the fins into the air. And you see that, yeah, this study you run this within maybe an hour, 2 hours, and then you already know what is the most optimal heatsink design. But that's the number of fins. Here you see it visible. This is an a plot in the top area of the heatsink. Yeah, important for heatsink is also that the length, so the length in the stream direction is not too long. If it is too long, then you see that in the top area, and that's also what you see in the top left picture, that the air temperature is already comparable with the heatsink temperature, with the fin temperature. Yeah, if both temperatures are in the same order of magnitude, then you don't have a temperature difference anymore. So you don't have a transfer of heat from the fins into the air. And so that that doesn't work anymore. And that's also why you see that if you increase the number of fins, yes, you have more surface area, but at the other hand, you fill up the channel for fresh air to come in, and you don't have any cooling effect anymore. Now, that's also what you see if you reduce the number of fins. If you go to 20 fins, you see that the air temperature in between the fins is becoming lower. And by 14 fins, you see that it's becoming more lower. And at 8 fins, you really see that the air is really low. So you have quite a delta between the fin and the air. So you have a lot of heat transfer there, but here, certainly at the 8 fin situation, you have two less fins, so two less surface area to bring the heat into the air. So there the most optimal is to increase the fin count. For instance, to 14 fins, you still see there that there's still a delta between the air and the fins, so the heatsink still works. Now, you can make nice flow pictures, how the air is going through and how much air is bypassing the heatsink. Certainly for a forced convection situation, that's important. But if you make use of a very dense heatsink in a channel and the air can bypass, then you will see that if the fins are too close, then most of the heat, the air will bypass the heatsink and the heatsink doesn't do its work. It's also, if you see, for instance, on you buy a heatsink based on the thermal specification. Some suppliers give heatsink performance for ductus flow, so that all the air is pressed through the fins. And other suppliers, but most of them not, give performance of heatsink in open channel, so that the air can also bypass. Those are more realistic for most applications. But of course, you can also benefit. If you can duct the flow, then you can get more benefit out of your heatsink. Another case, I was requested to look to a Peltier cooled fridge. Now, this was in modeling what should happen. I have a cooled chamber, but of course I can also heat it. If you look, for instance, to your fridges, what you can use in the car, which are based on the Peltier, you can both cool and heat the products. At the outside, we move external airflow through, and in between we have an air-to-air heat exchanger within the middle and a Peltier. And a Peltier is a device which can make a delta T between both sides by putting current through it. And we can benefit from that to have a cooling or a heating effect. So if you need to cool below ambient air temperature, then you can make use of Peltiers. So I like to test this if this works. This was the heat exchanger design, and we also like to test that. This is the Peltier. Now the Peltier is spec'd in such a way they give the sizes, but also they give here the performance, and they also have performance graphs available for that. So you have a certain amount of cooling power at certain hot side temperatures. You can gain then a maximum delta T, but that's at then you don't have cooling power. Cooling power is zero watts, and you can see how much current you have can put in. Virtually, yeah, of course, a Peltier device has a thermal resistance, so there is a coupling between the hot and the cold side, and you need to be aware of that. Now, this was a setup of the model where we modeled the heat exchanger within the middle of the Peltiers. All these kind of studies are possible within CFD. Most CFD packages have all the macros inside to model the fans, to model Peltiers, to model gap fillers, heat sinks. All that kind of stuff is already available, and it's not necessary to totally build it from scratch. The CFD can help you to make visible how the isolation did work in this case, how the air is moving through the heatsink, and if the object which needs to be cooled, in this case it was a bottle which needs to be cooled, if that is good enough. Now here you see that the internal temperature, it's nice within the expectation temperature within the of the tank is 8 degrees C with a power dissipation of 5 watts, what actually means that if you put a bottle in your fridge and the bottle is hot, hotter than the fridge, then it contains a certain amount of heat. And that heat has to be released to the environment, to the fridge in this case. Now you can study what the base temperature for the internal cooler is. You can see what the hot side is. And you can see how well it works. And if you do this together with, for instance, the Aztec tools, which are on the Laird website, then you can easily check if your Peltier is doing as expected and if it has sufficient performance. And that's what you see here. This is what is coming from that website. And I think also other Peltier companies can present this. Peltier, you have an optimal point with respect to COP. COP is coefficient of performance. The larger delta T you choose, the worse the COP is. And there is an optimal point. So yeah, if you can operate at the most optimal point, you can, then you will get most of the performance output, of course. Then you also have less cooling power. But these tools can really help you to just check how far the Peltier can cool down. And the thermal simulation did help us to really determine what is the isolation, what is the thermal performance from the heatsink into the air. And that's data you can then use in your thermal simulation tool, what is here on the website. So this is a combination of thermal simulations done to determine the parameters like thermal resistance and effect of airflow, isolation of the box, and these tools can present the performance of the Peltier. So you can really, by increasing the current through the Peltier, you can check what the operation points are. And you can see how well it cools. Now here you see in the bottom area, you see the hot side thermal resistance put in and the cold side thermal resistance. Those values were obtained from thermal simulations. You can change then the ambient temperature, you can change delta T, you can change the control temperature. And then you can check if your design works as expected. So the end result was that the Peltier-based cooler heater was able to bring the internal air down to 3 degrees C at 20 degrees C ambient. The available cooling power in that case was 6.3 watt. The COP was 150%, which is really good for a Peltier, but is mainly only possible if the cooling power is not too much and if the delta T is not too high. Otherwise, if you really have high delta T and high cooling and you require high cooling power, then you see that the COP even can go down to 30% or so, and that you have to put quite some power into your Peltier to make it work. But in this case, it worked quite well. Certainly when you cool down a bottle, initially you have a lot of heat because the bottle is hot when you put it in the fridge, but after it's cooled down, then the only thing what you need to cool away is the heat leakaging from outside via the isolation into your cooled fridge. Now, further you can, the lower the temperature and the more cooling power possible with high current setting. So you can easily control it, and you can also reduce the amount of cooling power by using other amps, so currents. You can further study the airflow over the tank, and you can optimize if needed. You can check the operational point of the fan, or you can even check if different fans better work for this situation. If you like to look for a better operation point or lesser noise, those things can be figured out by running thermal simulations. At the end, of course, you always have to run an experimental test to check if the what the actual behavior is and if that is in line with the thermal simulation. I can say here, I see your question that what is the difference between simulation and calculations? Yeah, normally I see if you set up a thermal simulation well, so put the right figures in, so not garbage in, garbage out, you're able to come to actual temperatures which are within 20% or so. That is possible, but yeah, really important here is to set up the thermal simulation well. At the other end, people always think that experiments are right, but also in experiments you can make quite some measurement errors. And yeah, if people start to check what the thermal simulation results are and compare it with experimental results, they say okay, and they only believe the experimental results, then you can see that you can have quite some differences there. But sometimes can help to really also simulate the way you perform your experimental tests, just to really see what the effect, for instance, of your experimental setup is. If you put flow sensors in, which are really disturbing the flow, or you put thermocouples in and the thermocouples are really too big and heat is removed by the thermocouple, this kind of things can also be simulated, and then you can check if it is more in line with your experiment. So also simulation can help you to set up better experiments. Also in a simulation you can see what is critical, in which location of your electronic box, what is critical there, and then you can put additional sensors in there. So in conclusion, thermal design of a system is a very complex 3D problem, and that is very difficult to just describe in just only analytical modeling, because yeah, it includes conduction, convection, and radiation heat transfer. Analytical tool can help you, but you need to put a lot of simplification in. Computational studies will really help you to put the problem in 3D, and then look to the conduction part, radiation part, convection part. So it gives also more view what's happening, and you can really check what the different effects are. Yeah, one of the most important benefits, what I see, but also what others see of CFD, is that you get insight in what the problem is. And after you change things, you really can see, okay, what is the change? And if you don't see a change, well, you did expect a change, expected an improvement, why isn't it happening? With CFD, it's much more easy to investigate what is the result, because in the whole domain what you simulate, you have multiple sensor point available, which is not possible in experimental test. Yeah, as said, simulation also help to determine what to test and where to measure. And yeah, at the end, you always need to run an experimental test to calibrate your computational model, because in the computation model you assume all kind of material properties, you make assumptions of interfaces. For instance, yeah, if you use the interface data presented by most suppliers, then in most cases you see much lower results, while in reality in your actual application thermal interface materials will behave differently and give also other results. This kind of stuff you can easily put in your simulation model, and you can also run some effects, what will happen if I change the performance of my interface material, what will be the overall results on my thermal simulation, so on the end result. So you can run a lot of sensitivity studies there. Good, this is what I like to tell for today. I don't know if there are questions. Yeah, if you like to know more, if Corona is gone, then we are planning to set up some more courses where I teach really this kind of stuff to help you with analytical modeling, but also with experimental modeling and computational modeling. but this gives you a flavor what really the benefit is of making use of CFD. And yeah, what I see nowadays, I see at a lot of companies, they make use of computational tools, and it's becoming so common to make use of it in the design of the board, of your systems. And yeah, you should certainly, what you see if people run into a problem during the first test of the full system, then simulation, we bring the simulation tool in place and show the benefit of that, then customers normally come back to us to really run thermal simulation during the start of the project to avoid this kind of problems happening anymore. So it's really powerful, and as a thermal engineer, it's very helpful to make use of this kind of tools. Okay, some questions I see in the chat. Even kijken. Now, as I already said, what's the difference between simulation, calculating, experimental testing? Now, I gave that at the beginning. Simulation, you can calculate temperatures within 20%. In calculations, well, we only make use of 1D thermal resistances, maybe 2Ds. You can calculate results up to between 20 and 50%. And experimental, you can obtain results within 10%, but also within experiment, you need to be very careful and need to know how our experiment is set up, what is the influence of your sensors putting in. Then another question is, how much detail can be added in a thermal simulation model? Now, you can go, as I said in the beginning, you can go as far as you like. If you really like to see what is happening in an IC, what is the temperature within the junctions of the IC, you're able to model that and to really see what is happening, how well is the heat spread to the silicon or to the gallium arsenide, how well is the heat spreaders in a component taking place. Also, things what you see is that component suppliers like an Intel and others are really also coming up for their high power FPGA and microprocessors with thermal models to really represent the behavior. And those thermal models make use of Delphi models or detailed geometries which can be used within the board simulations what you will run. And it gives you a really well prediction of the full thermal behavior of your of their components on your board. Good, some other questions. Let's see. A question if thermal simulation can also be done for liquid. Yes, this can be done. Within your simulation domain, you can make use of both air and liquid, only they cannot be in the same environment. So you have to really separate them from each other, but that's also what's happening in a cooling plate. So yes, you can model the whole liquid flow and you can model the air flow at the other side or the conduction. So you can make that visible. Also, I run quite some simulation in low gas pressures, H2 gas, nitrogen gas, but also in vacuum. All those kind of things can also be studied. And also there you can make use of cooling plate, cooling channels, and then check what the cooling effect will be. What kind of software is available and or recommended for doing this kind of simulations? There are quite some packages on the market. One of the most famous one is Flowtherm from Mentor and now Siemens. You also have we make use of 6 Sigma, the ET, which is from Future Facility, which is similar to Flowtherm. But also you have iSpec from Ansys, you have simulations tools, that kind of stuff. And yeah, there will be other tools available too. You also see that at university they make use console or so will be used where you can do multi-physics simulations. And yeah, also depending on the use, but in electronics cooling, the main packages what will be used is Sigma ET, Flowtherm, IcePack, and ANSYS simulations. Okay, I see that these were the questions. Yeah, if people don't have more questions, then I like to end the presentation. But by this, yeah, the slides will become available. You can, I think you can download them from the Telerex website. I think they will send a link for that. I saw something in the chat. And yeah, if you have more questions, you see my details on the last slide, but you can also contact Telerex direct. So then you can send me an email or give us a call, and then we can help you to answer questions. And if you have problems where we can help you or give some advice, yeah, please don't hesitate to call us. Okay, thank you for listening. And I hope it was beneficial for you, and it will help you to better understand and have some background what really the great users of this kind of simulation techniques.